Matt has sketched out a few things already, and we're going to be talking about, you know, taking advantage of VMware on the cloud, but with a little bit of a focus on lift and shift as well as transforming. So Matt, real quick, what do we have graphed out over here?
So right here is we're kind of picking up from where we left in our last webcast that we did with Jordan, where we talked about more just lifting and shifting the application, rehosting it, if you will, where we're more concerned about how do we get the application and the VM without changing anything about it into the cloud as quickly as possible, and extending that VM and all the network policy and everything underneath it into the cloud for consistent operations with on-premise and in the cloud.
Right. So last time, you know, we saw that with things like HCX, it was fairly easy to rehost capabilities from a VMware running on-prem to something running in the cloud.
Right.
Yeah. So that's what we have here.
Yeah, so right here you have on-premise, right, is what that site is supposed to represent. And then after lift and shift, you're in the state called cloud-hosted, like we talked about, where it's just more moving the application without changing anything about it, just to get the tactical benefits and the elasticity of moving to the cloud. And you know what we're talking about back at the desk is that by rehosting first and having your application live in the cloud brings a host of advantages in terms of app modernization. Because right now we're just focused on getting on the latest and greatest infrastructure that the cloud has to offer,
right.
And then after that, taking advantage of the automation and the scalability and the standardization of the cloud to layer on more services like OpenShift and like any other Kubernetes services out there.
So that's kind of this this time frame that we have laid out here.
Right.
So every step of the way, you know, you're starting on-prem, you're taking that next step to cloud hosted.
Right.
And now what's that next step? Like from that last kind of webcast that we did, we understood there was a lot of capabilities helping us here. But you know, at the end of the day, customers want to take advantage of higher value services and capabilities that you can get in something like IBM Cloud.
Exactly. They want to, like we were talking about, they want to start introducing cloud native services and then get as an organization, get more adapted to the value of being in the cloud, right? And the elasticity of that. So at that stage, we are now at what we call I'm going to try to make a nice square here. At cloud-enabled is what we call it. And in this phase, we are now taking advantage of being on the cloud network, right? Because now you're in the IBM clouds or the cloud in general, whatever cloud that might be. You're in their private network. You're taking advantage of the services that are on the private endpoints, and such as object storage or analytics services that might not require changing the application too much. You can still keep it in a VM.
Kind of like plug-and-play services.
Exactly. And you're not refactoring the application just yet. So from the application level, you're enriching it as much as you can. From the infrastructure level, you're taking advantage of the consumption models that the cloud has to offer and using things as needed. And
so
that's what we mean by
basically your VMs are continuing to run in a cloud environment, but now you're kind of reaching out and taking advantage of some of these cloud propositions, those cloud services.
Exactly. Yeah. To the extent that it can, with the application in, it's probably, most likely it's in a three-tier architecture, right? You have your web tier, your app tier, and your database tier.
Right.
And as much as you can integrate services in that kind of architecture, you're taking advantage of that in the cloud-enabled stage.
Right. So now it's less about just lift and shift and more about transform.
Right.
Maybe you have to get in there sometimes, change some things around, call some third-party APIs.
Right.
That kind of thing.
Exactly. And then after, you've from an operational perspective, you're more adapted and ready to take the next step. This is where we introduce OpenShift in Kubernetes. You have this VMware estate that now lives in the cloud. You have the VMs there. You have your legacy applications living on top of them. Now you can start to think about replatforming or even rehost, or it's not rehosting. You can start re-architecting or refactoring the application. So here you'll see that we'll have the VM here. And then you'll see that we have we're going to use a container right here. So this is what we're going to use to label a container. And this is still kind of you're not fully cloud native yet. So we're going to call this cloud enabled as well. And at this stage, you have
side by side, like VMs working alongside containers
exactly.
in the same environment.
Assuming all the networking pieces are in place below and you have this common network fabric, and that's the value that NSX from VMware brings, is that you can have this common network fabric across containers and VMs. Now you're able to start thinking about, all right, I want to keep my database as a VM because that's stateful, right?
Right.
And I have these stateless components of my application that don't really rely on storage as much and can be containerized and replatformed. And that's what we're doing here. And it's kind of like this hybrid world or the application is living as containers and also as a VM too.
Right.
And so this, you know, assuming this is a old monolithic heritage application, that that there are some benefits that the app tier and the web tier can get out of being a container.
Exactly. So let's say in that VM, like you mentioned, we had all three tiers. What if we break apart a front end that can really take advantage of things like cloud auto-scaling capabilities and the fact that you can distribute that cloud application across data centers, you know, all over the world where IBM Cloud has data centers, basically allowing that front end that's not, you know, stateful, it's a stateless application, to take better advantage of cloud native concepts right away.
Right.
Whereas kind of those legacy apps, those VMs, where you have to start thinking about refactoring if you wanted to make them cloud native, kind of changing that stateful layer, those might take some more time.
Right.
So that's that halfway step, that modernization step.
Exactly. This is the in-between phase. And really, this part of the story here is really what the value of lift, shift, and transform is that customers are doing this at their own pace. It's not a sushi roll of a solution that they need to take a bite of the whole thing altogether, whether there's pieces of that sushi they don't like, right?
Right.
So they're able to take it step by step here, mm-hmm. and in a way that makes sense to them, that fits their strategic goals, right?
Makes sense.
And you know, there's some other numbers out there. You know, there's 50 million VMs that are still out there in the world today, mm-hmm. right? And a lot of most business applications still run on VMs. So I think it's wise to realize that the future will still have VMs in it, and we'll probably see scenarios like this where we have databases living in VMs still, but you have all the client interfacing mm-hmm. parts of the application all containerized and able to introduce new functionality to it.
Right. I mean, there's still some capabilities out there that were written, you know, in like the 70s and 80s that are still chugging along that no one wants to go in there and change those out.
Exactly. And like we talked about back there, that, you know, the people that actually wrote, the teams that wrote those applications, mm-hmm. they're long gone. And it's lost in translation. So
I'm guessing, you know, you hinted at where you're going with this last phase here. The end of all of this modernization phase, mm-hmm. we're going to have
cloud native.
There we go.
So by this point, you know, we've kind of decoupled the application from virtual machines altogether, at least the parts that are, you know, in containers now. Mm-hmm. So we don't really need to rely on hypervisors as much anymore. We can kind of that application is abstracted enough that we can start taking advantage of higher value services like OpenShift as a service.
Yeah.
So you don't really have to rely on the actual hardware anymore. You can take advantage of this of services that IBM Cloud provides that make OpenShift more of like an endpoint,
right,
where you're only bursting as much OpenShift capacity that you need for your application to run and to develop with it. So let me draw this out here. So you have your application here, and it's running now on let me label it cloud native.
That's right. So this is kind of when you've phased out some of those legacy applications.
Right.
Many of your assets aren't required to run as a VM anymore.
Right. So then you're taking advantage of, let me get my green marker here, of services like our managed Kubernetes service here. Mm-hmm. And also, now that you're at this cloud native development stage, you can start taking advantage of other microservices. And you yourself have turned your application into microservices too.
Right.
So that it's just working much, you know, where you've achieved this cloud native development state.
Right. So there we're taking advantage of, you know, we have machine learning capabilities, higher value AI, those capabilities that really enable you, like kind of like we mentioned, to create more engaging applications that are connecting to your end users just a little bit better.
Right.
So, Matt, this was really helpful to be able to actually sketch this out and show how, you know, every step of the way with VMware solutions on IBM Cloud, you're supported kind of every phase of that modernization path.
Right.
If you have any questions, please drop us a line below. If you want to see more videos like this in the future, please like and subscribe. And don't forget, you can always get started in the cloud at no cost by signing up for a free IBM Cloud account.